In the time that you gave me, did I give all I could give? Did I love all I could love? Did I live all I could live? Was my faith in your grace strong enough to save me? Did I do all I could do in the time that you gave me?
In the time that you gave me, did I face the devil down? Did I make him turn away every time I stood my ground? If today is the day you should decide to take me, did I do all I could do in the time that you gave me? Oh, and I'll never know till it's over, but I wanna fly on your shoulders. Might have strayed from the path, I might have gone a little crazy. I'd like to think I did you proud in the time that you gave me.
Time that you gave me. Oh, and as the hourglass empties, well, it won't even face me. If I did all I could do in the time that you gave me.
If I did all I could do in the time that you gave me.
Gathered here this morning to celebrate the life of a very special lady. We honor in many different ways with a wide variety of memories that we will all carry with us throughout our lives. And regardless of the nature of our relationship with her or the varied experience each one of us shared with her, there are some things that we all have in common. We all love her. We treasure her life and the life that we shared with her, and we all knew that love was reciprocated. And our lives are forever marked, forever impacted, changed forever because Stephanie Miner lived. Because she was a part of our lives, we are forever changed. Stephanie Lynn Miner was born April 22nd, 1974, in Trenton, Michigan, to Robert Miner and Hilda Keating Miner. She passed away Saturday, January 30th, 2021 at Decatur Morgan Hospital. She was preceded in death by her grandparents, John and Catherine Miner, her grandmother, Sue Keating. Stephanie worked as a greeter for Walmart for 13 years and was a graduate of the 2017 class of Calhoun Community College. She served on the Governor's Committee from 2017 until the present, and was a governor-appointed committee member on the Alabama State Independent Living Council and the Alabama Council on Developmental Disabilities. And Stephanie brought joy to everyone who knew her, and she was a special aunt. She is survived by her parents, Bob and Hilda Miner, grandfather, Noah Keating. Would you pray with me today? Father, we thank you once again for this precious life that was given to for all of us to enjoy, to experience the great gift that you gave to us through Stephanie. today, as we come together, Lord, we want to remember, to celebrate this life. Lord, I ask today that you would bring to remembrance in each one of us as we share, Lord, bring to remembrance our own experiences, our own times with her, the things that she said, the things that she did that made such an impact on our lives. And Father, in all of our time together and in the days to come, we pray that your abiding peace would be with each one that's gathered here and all the family and friends whom you, God, that you would help us in our own sorrow. Oh Lord, help us also to rejoice with Stephanie for her great gain in this moment. Now Lord, speak to us here today. Bring comfort to those who are here today. Let your presence be felt in this place. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Knowing Stephanie was life-changing. Her smile was just amazing. It was radiant. Her joy was contagious. It was impossible to spend time with Stephanie and not have a smile on your face. She wouldn't let you. She would be, if you couldn't smile, if you couldn't be joyful, she would be concerned about what was going on. But her joy was contagious. She brought so much joy to everybody around her. One of my earliest experiences that really has stayed with me all these years, I knew Stephanie for almost 30 years. And we were at a church here in town, and we were taking the youth group on a trip to Six Flags, and Stephanie wanted to go. So we wanted Stephanie to be with us. She was a part of the group, and we wanted her to be there. And, you know, it was... I know for the family, they were concerned because they knew the challenges of life and anything. You know, if you took Stephanie somewhere, it was challenging. There were extra challenges. But to be able to take her with us was such an awesome thing for us because she got to experience those things with us. And we got to experience them in a different way through her eyes. And it actually worked out for our benefit. Because if you go to a theme park, and you've got someone in a wheelchair, guess what? You get to bypass all the lines. And Stephanie loved that, you know? She wasn't a very patient person. I do know that. You know? And so if we'd had to stay in those lines all day, I don't know that it would have been such a great experience for her. But because of her circumstances, we bypassed all the lines and we went to the very front. And I remember every time that we would line up for a ride, they would say, "Now, where do you want to sit?" They gave her the option to sit anywhere she wanted. Well, every roller coaster, Stephanie wanted to ride in the front. And they said, "Now, how many times do you want to ride? You can ride once or twice. And if you want to ride twice, you'll just stay on the second time and we won't get you off." She said, "I want to ride twice." And so we rode every ride at Six Flags. And every one of those roller coasters, we were on the front row and we rode it twice. And we had a blast. And I've carried those memories with me all these years, and I will never, ever forget that day. You know, there's a lot of things that come and go through life, and maybe conversations that you know, I may not remember all the words, but I remember the experience of just being with her and her passion for life. And so, you know, it's that amazing, contagious joy that she possessed while dealing with what we would see as struggles, what we would see as hindrances. But she, you know, she never complained. She didn't make excuses. You know, she embraced life, and if she wanted to do something, then she was going to try to figure out a way to do it. And she was very determined. I don't know many people who would have endured 24 years of schooling to get her degree. But she was determined. Oh, did she get discouraged? Of course, just like anybody else. She had her days where she was discouraged, but discouragement didn't stop her. She was determined. Even with math, as much as she hated math, she was determined. Or as she said, math hated her. But even in something that she didn't care about so much, she found a way to make it a blessing in somebody else's life and used, you know, actually tutored others in math in something that she didn't even care about. All of her time working at Walmart, how many people have the opportunity to do what Stephanie did? Because for Stephanie, it wasn't just a job, because that joy that she possessed, it was an opportunity to interact with people every day, to impact somebody's life, to bring a smile to their face. It's something that she didn't have to do. She didn't have to work. She didn't have to go get a job. She wanted to. How many of you would want to do that? You know? We endure our work sometimes, but Stephanie wanted to go and do it. And she made no excuses of why she couldn't. And she just wanted to bring a smile to people's faces. In fact, we were talking about, you know, you remember those smiley face stickers that they used to give you when you walked in Walmart sometimes? I don't guess they give those out anymore. Well, Stephanie didn't really care for the smiley face stickers. So she went and bought her own stickers to give to kids when they came in, until they told her she couldn't do that. But she took the time to think about how she could bring joy to somebody else's life, to all those children who walked through. You know, I've talked to so many people that maybe didn't know Stephanie personally on a very personal level, but they knew her from Walmart. And they knew the experience they had when they walked through the door, the joy that she brought to their lives. And she made everybody around her comfortable with her circumstances. Especially children. Sometimes when young children come around someone with a disability, with a handicap, it's uncomfortable because they don't know how to respond, because it's something they're not accustomed to. But Stephanie had a way of making everybody feel comfortable being around. In fact, no other way. Just get the kids on the wheelchair and go for a ride. You know, that was her. But many times you look past the handicap. You look past what we would see as a disability, and you saw such joy for life in Stephanie. Stephanie was bold, confident. She was not easily intimidated by things that would happen around her or to her. And when she was given the opportunity to speak, you put a microphone in her hand, put a microphone in front of her, she was going to just open up and speak. It didn't intimidate her. A crowd didn't intimidate her. A TV camera didn't bother her at all. In fact, she would speak into that microphone, or to that crowd, or to that TV camera, just like she would talk to you, without any concern about all the people or whether or not they're going to like what I have to say. No, she was going to speak with what was in her heart, and she was going to express it very, very well, with great confidence. She always spoke with consistency and confidence, just like she was talking to you one-on-one. And Stephanie was a believer in Christ. That's one of the reasons why we can come here today and we can truly celebrate her life. Because we know that this is not the end. This is just the beginning for Stephanie. And what we see as sorrow is actually her day of rejoicing. Because no longer is she restricted by this physical body, but she is actually now, she has a new life, and she is free from all the things that held her back in this life. She was a believer. I remember some of my earliest days with her. I remember some things about her that just challenged me. And how we approach life sometimes with our excuses, with our mediocrity. Many times when I was living here in the area, and I would be at church, and Bob would bring Stephanie there to the service, and she would bring her wheelchair down to the row that I was sitting on, and she would park her wheelchair at the end of my row. And then she would pick herself up and get out of her chair and sit in the chair next to me. And I still remember the days when we would be in worship, and I would look over, and Stephanie had pulled herself up to stand and hold on to chair in front of her so that she could stand and worship just like everybody else. How many times in worship have we been so reserved, content to just stay in our seat, to not be passionate in our worship? She didn't have that hold her back. Her situation didn't hold her back. She was going to stand and she was going to worship everybody else. Like I said, she could have come up with plenty of excuses and nobody would have blamed her. There were no excuses with Stephanie. And so as you remember Stephanie today and in the days to come, you know, no doubt you're going to feel emotions. As Isaiah 4, verse 13 declares, it says, "For I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you." And as he helped Stephanie through life, I promise you that he will help you in the days to come in dealing with your own emotions and dealing with your own life as you walk out the life that you have ahead of you. And Stephanie would tell you today, when it comes to your emotions, it's okay to be sad. It's okay. But just don't stay there. Don't stay there. Don't let that dominate you. I don't want to share this poem. I believe that if Stephanie could speak to us personally today, I believe that she would say something much like this. When tomorrow starts without me, and I'm not there to see, if the sun should rise and find your eyes all filled with tears for me, I wish so much you wouldn't cry the way you did today, while thinking of the many things we didn't get to say. I know how much you love me, as much as I love you, and each time that you think of me, I know you'll miss me too. But when tomorrow starts without me, please try to understand that an angel came and called my name and took me by the hand and said my place was ready in heaven far above and that I'd have to leave behind all those I dearly love. But as I turned to walk away, a tear fell from my eye. For all my life, I'd always thought I didn't want to die. I had so much to live for, so much left yet to do. It seemed almost impossible that I was leaving. I thought of all the yesterdays, the good ones and the bad. I thought of all the love we shared and all the fun we had. If I could relive yesterday just even for a while, I'd say goodbye and kiss you and maybe see you smile. But then I fully realized that this could never be, for emptiness and memories would take the place of me. When I thought of worldly things that I might miss tomorrow, I thought of you, and when I did, my heart was filled with sorrow. But when I walked through heaven's gates, I felt so much at home. When God looked down and smiled at me from his great golden throne, he said, "This is eternity, and all I've promised you. Today, your life on earth is past, but here life starts anew. I promise no tomorrow, but today will always last. And since each day is the same, there's no longing for the past. You've been so faithful, so trusting, and so true. Though there were times you did some things you knew you shouldn't do. But you've been forgiven. And now at last, you're free. So won't you come and take my hand and share my life with me?" So when tomorrow starts without me, don't think we're far apart. Every time you think of me, I'm right there in your heart. Carrie, would you come share a word?
I'm one of Stephanie's 8 first cousins on the minor side of the family, and I couldn't let this day pass without talking for all of the cousins. For most of our growing up years, our families were spread out across the country. At times, some were even outside of the United States. Because of the distance, those rare holidays and other occasions spent together as cousins were particularly memorable and special. You may have seen some of the photos from those events during the slideshow. Steph was always right in the middle of all those events. For example, there was the Christmas in Nebraska when Steph's new doll kept talking and talking and talking until someone finally decided to take the batteries out. And I don't think she liked that very much. There was our big minor family trip to Disney World when I remember waiting in line for the submarines and Steph was excited about getting on that ride. It wasn't an easy ride to get on for anybody. It had a very steep ladder. But her uncles and her dad and her mom made sure she got to get on that ride, and we all enjoyed it together. There were times that Steph butted heads with our grandma. I don't think there were two stronger-willed women that exist in the world. And I think most of us would have just gotten out of the way whenever that happened. There were many times spent playing cards and board games, which Steph loved. If the game or the table conversation happened to be humorous or silly, that was even better, because it meant might get Steph laughing. You all know that infectious laugh that I'm talking about. Her laughter was far more fun than any game we were playing. As we all got older and moved into college and adulthood, Steph appointed herself what I would now call as cousin superglue. She always kept track of what each of us were up to and later what all of our kids were doing. She had an amazing memory for details, and she never missed calling us on our birthdays when she would give us the rundown of what the other cousins were up to. She kept us connected to one another even as the distance got further and the times we got to see each other was longer. But of all my memories of Steph, the most powerful one I have was when she was about 3 or 4 years old. We were visiting and getting ready to leave, and I think she was at the age where she finally noticed that she was different than the rest of us. And I just remember her crying and saying, "When do I get to walk like Andy and Carrie?" You can imagine that's a pretty profound statement for someone her age. Well, we have the answer. I'm thrilled to know that because of our shared faith in Christ, the next time I get to see Steph, she will be walking just like Amy and Carrie. Stephanie, although we might be kind of cousins, we'll miss your smiles, your laughter, and your unwavering love here in this life. We don't begrudge you one moment of the freedom and joy you're experiencing right now. We won't say goodbye, but see you later. We love you, and we are so proud to be your cousins.
The book of Isaiah, it says, "My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts," God says, "and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine." You know, as we think about Stephanie's life, in many ways the world saw Stephanie as handicapped. They saw her as hindered and restricted. And I think about how God used Stephanie in so many ways, to show us how handicapped we are. How many days we spend hindered and restricted in our own life. You know, it's my hope for every one of us who knew Stephanie that we learned something from her. Because I know I did. Because she showed us in so many ways. She showed us how to live. She showed us how to love. How to embrace opportunity. How to live with confidence. She showed us how to just be yourself and make no apologies for being who you are. She didn't leave things unsaid either. If she thought it, she'd say it. And so if you knew Stephanie, you knew that she loved you. She made that clear. She never felt sorry for herself. And she wouldn't want you to feel that way either. She wouldn't want you to feel sorry for her then, and she definitely would not want you to feel sorry for her now. But she never, never felt sorry for herself. And I can say that from my perspective, from what I knew of her, and I believe for all of us, we can honestly say that she lived her life. She lived it wide open.
From the day that I was born, I've learned to live with how things are. I'll never step up to the microphone or strum my own guitar. For over 30 years now, I've been sitting in this chair. When people stop and ask me if I think life's been unfair, I say, I feel sorry for the hard-working mother raising children on her own. And I feel sorry for the man who has to call a cold underpass his home. And all the lonely people out there who cannot find a friend. Yeah, I feel sorry for them. Pocket and good boots upon my feet, and a healthy mom and daddy, they live just down the street. A God who gives me mercy those times when I've gone wrong, and another day to pour my heart into a song. So I feel sorry for the one their house blown away in a hurricane. And I feel sorry for the ones who lost somebody on that sad September day. And anybody who hates somebody for the color of their skin. Yeah, I feel sorry for them. That the lucky ones are the ones who love the most. For all the lonely people out there who cannot find a friend, yeah, I feel sorry for them.
Billy Graham wrote in his book, Facing Death, he said, today we are told how to look young, to stay trim, keep healthy, and have a good image, and think positively, and make more money, and have more friends. All these, he said, indicate that we're trying desperately to cling to this present world. The truth is that life is transitory. He says, what is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. If you want to make the most of life, then we need to face the fact that it's going to end. Death is a part of the human condition. It is part of life. We can find comfort as well through the scriptures, as Jesus says in the book of John. He says, let not your heart be troubled. He says, you believe in God, believe also in me. That in my Father's house are many mansions, and if it were not so, I would have told you. And I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know. And the way, you know. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. You know, it's difficult for our minds sometimes to even truly fathom the magnitude of these words, that Jesus has prepared a place for us. He's prepared a place for you. He prepared a place for Stephen. A heavenly and eternal home that is prepared for us. But there's only one way to this home. Only one way. And Jesus said, I am the way. He is the door by which we enter. In John chapter 10, verse 9, Jesus said, I am the door, and if anyone enters by me, he will be saved. Scripture goes on to tell us that we know that if our earthly house, this body, this tent, is destroyed, that we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, that is eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from heaven. We are confident. We are confident, yes, well pleased to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. The Bible is very clear that to be absent from the body, for those who are in Christ, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I believe that when Stephanie breathes her last breath on this earth, she stepped into a new life that is beyond our comprehension. Because she knew Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of her life. She stepped through the door and into the life that he had prepared for her. It's difficult for us sometimes to accept that this life that each one of us lives is only temporary. It's a reality that all of us must face. We celebrate the birth of a child, but yet with each birthday celebration, there is also that reality that we're also moving closer to the day of our departure from this world. And when that day arrives, as it has for Stephanie, we mourn. Because we hurt. We feel that loss. But as we mourn our loss today, I say to you today that today is a day of great rejoicing because of Stephanie's gain. She's received today what her faith was looking forward to, what had been promised to her. She stepped through that door and received her reward. So, you know, in birth, we begin to die. But in death, we finally begin to live. Today, Stephanie is more alive than she's ever been before. And doing all the things that she couldn't do in this temporary life. No limitations, no weakness, nothing lacking. She can walk, she can run, she can dance. Now, the Apostle Paul had such a glorious vision of eternity in heaven that he actually talked about the turmoil that he was experiencing over his desire to depart this world and to be with Christ. He realized that there was nothing in this life that offered anything in comparison to what had been promised to him in eternity. He said, for I am hard-pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you, he said. So this is the reality that in dealing with times like this, and dealing with our own mortality, to be properly prepared to deal with not only Stephanie's death, but also our own. That to depart and be with Christ is better. She is in a better circumstance, better situation than we are in this moment. And when this truth becomes a reality in your life, death loses its sting. Death loses its sting. This is why the writer of the book of Ecclesiastes said that a good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death better than the day of one's birth. Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble. But I can promise you that through Christ, he said, in this world you won't have trouble. But be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. And through Christ we have the promise of a world without pain, without sorrow, without suffering. And so the scriptures remind us that what we see in this world is only temporary, but what is not seen is eternal. In this life, its joys and its struggles, they're temporary. But there is an eternal reality that is greater than anything that we can see, feel, or comprehend fully in this world. Heaven and eternity are beyond our greatest and wildest expectations. Heaven is a place of no more sorrow, no more pain, no more crying. Heaven is a place of eternal beauty, the eternal home for those who have placed their trust in Jesus. And I remind you once again today that Jesus is the door to this eternal home. There is no other way. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. So we rejoice today knowing that Stephanie has stepped through the door, that she's experiencing this life that is promised to us through the scriptures. But for all of us here today, we are faced with the reality of the life that we must live. And I ask you today, before we pray, do you have that confidence that Stephanie had? That beyond this life, that there's something more. That one day that you can step out of this world and into a life that is far more magnificent than anything that you've ever experienced here. This is the hope that we have in Christ. That death is not the end, but is actually the beginning of all that He intended for us to have. Do you have that confidence today? And as we pray today, I ask that you would seek your own heart. Where are you in dealing with your own mortality, your own life? Would you pray with me today? Father, I thank you for all that are gathered here, those who have loved Stephanie and have been loved by her. And Lord, we thank you again for this great gift that you've given us over all these years through this life that we encounter. Lord, I pray now that as we are all facing the circumstances that brought us here, Lord, help us to also search our own hearts, to prepare ourselves for the day when we depart this world. But I pray that you would draw each and every one of us into that place of relationship with you, that we can have the confidence that Stephanie had, that she had Christ in her heart, and that she was also in His. That a day of great rejoicing we will experience for ourselves if we place our trust in you. As we continue with our heads bowed in prayer, I want to give you an opportunity to respond to the promises of God. The promise of salvation, the promise of eternal life. Jesus said He is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through Him. And today, if you will call upon Him as Lord and Savior, if you'll surrender your life to Him, you can not only have the assurance of eternal life beyond this physical existence, but also have the joy and the peace that Stephanie possessed in this life through the presence of God in her daily life. So if you'd like to place your trust in her today, you can just pray this prayer along with me. Father God, I come to you today seeking to know you, to have you in my life. I ask you, Jesus, to come into my heart, to take this life that I have and to make it all that you desire for it to be. And all that I have and all that I am, I give to you. And I thank you that as I give you my life, you give to me eternal life. Father, I pray that you would bless each one, Lord, who prayed this prayer today, that you would help them in their days to come, to follow after you, to know you in this life, and have the assurance beyond this world. And Lord, we ask once again that you would give peace and comfort to all those who are here today, all the family and friends who were impacted by Stephanie's life. God, that you would bring the comfort that we need during this time, but Lord, also bring to mind the wonderful memories, the great joy that we experienced in sharing life with her. And And Lord, let us carry on the great life lessons that she taught us. Let us step into a greater life with no excuses, with greater passion, with greater boldness, as we learn from the life that Stephanie exhibited for all of us. We thank you, God, for your presence in this place and for the days to come. In Jesus' name.
There came a kind and gentle man from a town called Galilee. Spent his whole life reaching out to folks like you and me. He said his Father sent him bearing gifts from up above. To those believing in him, he offered faith, hope, and love. With his arms wide open, he walked from town to town with his arms wide open, that each lost sheep might be found. From the youngest to the old, to the weak and wayward souls, with his arms wide open, he came gathering his fold. When he talked about his kingdom, well, it threw the kings a curve. Cause with all his Father's power, he said he came to serve. The weary and the destitute were the ones that he called friends. No wonder he had prostitutes and even lepers follow him. With his arms wide open, he welcomed one and all with his arms wide open. He tore down all those walls, from sinners filled with shame to the blind and the lame. With his arms wide open, he loved them all the same. When his days on earth were through, he'd given all that he could give. So it's no surprise that he died the same way that he lived, with his arms wide open. He hung there from a cross with his arms wide open, that not one soul would be lost. He turned the other cheek when they nailed him to a tree. With his arms wide open, he rescued you and me. With his arms wide open, he set this sword with his arms wide open, he bought our eternity. There came a kind and gentle man from a town called Galilee.